Thank you, U of C's O'Brien Institute for Public Health and the School of Public Policy for bringing André Picard to Calgary. I know that we are in for a thoroughly thought-provoking evening, so please enjoy.
My name is Bill Galley, and I'm the director of the O'Brien Institute for Public Health at the University of Calgary. And picking up from Pat's opening comments, I'd first of all like to say that we're very excited to be co-hosting tonight's event with the School of Public Policy at the University of Calgary and also the Calgary Public Library. The O'Brien Institute for Public Health is one of the seven health research institutes at the University of Calgary. And as an institute, we've existed since 2010. And we have a goal of advancing knowledge and informing public policies for health in this province, but also nationally and internationally. And we have a broad membership of over 400 members, many of whom are within the University of Calgary community, but also many others within Calgary Health Alberta Health Services, the City of Calgary, the Ministry of Health, various public health agencies across the province. And with our diverse membership, one of our main activities is convening discussions around things that matter to citizens, things that matter to patients in the healthcare system, things that matter to people. And that's actually the theme of tonight. We have a book entitled Matters of Life and Death, written by, as Pat has mentioned, a leading public health journalist internationally, certainly Canada's leading public health journalist, André Picard. And we have had the pleasure of hosting André in the past within the O'Brien Institute for Public Health, and we have learned so much from André. And this is, I think, the biggest thing to say about André. He holds a huge number of awards. Public Health Journalist of the Year, Public Health Journalist of the Americas, many international awards, national awards. I think most of us can give the testimonial that André is a teacher. We all wake up with André and we have our breakfast cereal or whatever we want to eat, and he's there. And he has a remarkable clarity in the way he writes, clearly the way he thinks, and I believe that he is shaping public policy for health and contributing significantly to a national discourse that really affects us all. So thank you, André, for taking time to come to Calgary. Thank you for this book that you have contributed. I'm going to introduce you a little more as we get you up on the stage. We're also fortunate in the Institute to have a number of colleagues and partners who are going to be part of today's program, and I will elaborate in the introductions as the individuals come up.
Just to talk about the book very briefly, what it is a collection of columns. So I'm a columnist at the Globe and Mail, and what I want to do in the book is give people a sense of how much stuff goes on in healthcare. So there are 80 different columns in there on 80 different topics, and that's just a tip of the iceberg. So there's always new issues and things to write about, which makes my job both difficult and easy. There's never a shortage of stuff, but you can never get to all the important issues. So you'll see we're going to try and give you a taste of many of these subjects tonight, from what's wrong with Medicare, what's right with Medicare, opioids, marijuana, all the issues of the day, right to die, all the hot topics we'll touch on. The hardest part of the book for me was going back and looking through many years of columns. And when I first was approached by the publisher, he said, you know, he wanted to do this, but he said he was kind of worried that they would be outdated. And I said, spontaneously, I actually said, oh, not to worry, nothing ever changes in healthcare. And then I realized after a while that was actually true. So that was depressing. But then as we put the book together, I realized it did need a lot of updating, because when you write stuff, when you write current events, often the context is known to people. So I had to go in and sort of rejig the columns. And some of them became almost greatest hits. So I realized at one point I want to include a column about the abortion pill. And I realized that I first wrote about it 28 years ago, and that I had written six times subsequently on the issue, saying the same thing every time, because it is now available in this province just in recent months. It took 28 years to get a drug to market that's been used in Europe. So it's just an example of how we're We can be fairly bureaucratic and slow in Canada, and I'll be giving you a number of quips like that tonight. So I think I'll just stop talking and invite people to come and ask me questions.
All right. So before we start, I'll just introduce Dr. P.G. Forrest a little bit more. So P.G. is, as I mentioned, the director of the School of Public Policy, and he's a fairly new recruit to the University of Calgary, just here about a year ago, I recall. And before coming to the University of Calgary, he was at Johns Hopkins School of Public Health in a health policy research and academic position and teaching position at Johns Hopkins, and then prior to that was with the Trudeau Foundation, as well as a number of other leadership roles in health and in medicine and in academia. He's now also holder of the Palmer Chair in Health Policy or in Policy at the University of Calgary. So, PG, I'll turn it over to you, and we're going to team up on André.
So, yeah, I know André for a very long time. I think we met running, actually, along the canal in Ottawa at the time of the Romano Commission. I was director of research of the commission, and so I think this is the first time we met in front of the chateau in Ottawa. So one of my questions, so I spent a part of the weekend reading the book, a lot of good memories, and I was wondering, you know, and in fact, I'm very humbled by when I read all this, because I wonder how do you do to always fight the good fights, you know, to be on the right side of history. The health policy community in Canada is I won't say it's conservative because it's very progressive, but it tends to have some high degree of groupthink. And you have taken positions that are outside of the consensus in a community that tends to give a lot of importance to consensus.
Yeah, maybe if they're progressive and they're conservative, we can call them progressive conservative. that used to be popular. I think I have the privilege, I have this bully pulpit. What I do well is I summarize things. So really, all the columns are based on ideas from very smart people. And I'm not that smart, but I can summarize what they say in a way that's digestible. So I see myself as a translator. So people write this learned research, they do, you know, really big words, and I boil them down to, you know, I often say, you know, how would I explain this to my mom? You know, my mom was barely graduated from high school, but that's who healthcare matters to. It's people like my mom to people who need the healthcare. So I think that's the role of the journalist, is to make it digestible and understandable. These seemingly complex issues are not, if they're too complex, then they're not good policy. That's my view. So I have the benefit of a lot of people helping me out. And, you know, there's a lot of, all the most important part of my column are the people are not quoted who I talk to. And that makes it easier for me to talk to them, frankly. So I think that's how I end up, I hope, most of the time on the right side of history, but sometimes probably not.
Your position on the right to die, for instance, has been more radical than any other columnist in the country.
Well, you know what I've learned from really smart public health people like yourself over the year is the key to being a good practitioner or of public health is to be pragmatic. To look at the evidence, judge, you know, what is the impact going to be on individuals, and that's how you have to decide policy. You can't base it on, oh, it's going to offend some people, it's going to put some political noses out of joint, it's going to cost money. You have to do it on it has to be, you know, almost ethical. And that's, I think, to me, I did get a lot of grief over the right to die stuff, for example. My position on drugs, a lot of people take offense with. We'll talk about that later. I'm very much become over the years a libertarian on drugs. But the evidence tells me that's what has to be done. And yeah, and sometimes it makes me uncomfortable, makes some of the public uncomfortable. That doesn't matter. You have to do ultimately, here's the right thing or the wrong thing, and we have to try and choose the right one.
How do you know that you have it right when you write, when you take a stand? Because clearly many people open their newspapers and they see there's a headline. Like I actually just recently, I'd had a number of interesting conversations about the teen, the teen fiction Netflix series 13 Reasons Why, and was hearing interesting discussion about, oh, is it healthy to have this kind of public discourse, or are there concerns about suicide, contagion, and glorification? And then, lo and behold, on a Monday morning, there's André. And I read it, and I think, wow, the clarity that he has. And I think many of us are really, you know, in some ways, I find it surprising that you can see things so clearly, and they give you 650 words, and that's all you get. We academics, we just can't get that right. And yet, you really get it. It seems so clear and so right when we read it from you. But for you, that must be a burden when you have to write a column in the morning. How can you get it right?
Well, I probably don't. I think many people are going to be, and they are unhappy, and they certainly let me know about it. So, you know, I think that the public keeps you humbled, you know, because there's this constant feedback. And Globe readers are very nitpicky, you know, any little comma out of place they let you know about. And that's good. It keeps you on your toes. And things like, 13 Reasons Why, that column, you know, a lot of people would say the exact opposite of you. They're irresponsible. How dare you say that? The evidence is not what you said. And that's fine. I say, you know, I take a position and I back it up as best I can with evidence as best I can. And I tap into the knowledge of smart people. In that case, my daughter, you know, we binge watched 13 Reasons Why with a teenager, which is ultimately what I wrote about. That's how you should do. Because I was talking to her about it. What do you think about this? People are saying, she was reading a story in the Montreal Gazette saying the school board was saying that this should be banned. And she's kind of, turning up her nose at that. Oh yeah, fat chance, you know, a lot of good that's going to do. We've all seen it. And I realized, yeah, she's right. It's like the horse is out of the barn. So what do we do now? And I thought, as we were having that discussion, I thought, that's the column I haven't read. I've read all these, things about, oh my, this is terrible. Oh, every kid who watches this is going to kill themselves. And I didn't think that was credible, but I didn't think about, listen, they've all seen it, so what are we going to do about it? And so that's the position I took. And I thought that was an important point of view to get out there, but it still made lots of people, probably as many people angry as it made people, relieved or happy or whatever.
And just a follow-up question on that theme of getting it right or getting it wrong. Can you tell us a story of a column or columns that you've written that caused uproar? And then on second thought, oh, maybe I should have spun it differently.
I tried to. I don't think it's the... No, I think you have second thoughts on every single one. So I don't think there's any one, but I don't think it's useful to have regrets. I'm a very much in the what's done is done person, and let's move on. There's stuff where I've taken positions where, later on my position evolves, and I think that's the way. I always say journalism to me is like science in that it's self-correcting. I think we jump to conclusions, we make mistakes, we assume things. I'll give you an example. I used to be a big enthusiast about screening. Cancer screening is the most important thing. If you catch cancer early, it's going to save lives. And that all made perfect sense. And now, and that was 20 years ago, 15 years, 10 years ago, I started thinking, maybe it's not so great. Maybe we should be targeting instead of doing universal screening. Because universal screening isn't universal. The people who don't need it get it. So I started writing that. That wasn't popular with the Cancer Society. And now I realize that, and science, I think, is realizing that this belief, this really logical belief that catching cancer early is going to save lives, is essentially, it's not true. And it's depressing as hell, but it's not true. So, some people like me, I can say that because my grants don't depend on it or whatever, but, somebody has to say it. And I sometimes often get to say those uncomfortable things. And that's the other thing, the people you talked about, how do I get it right? A lot of people come to me who they know stuff and they can't really say it because of their position or because of, they're dependent on this. And I they know that I can say it. So that, again, I depend on these smart people.
One of the the topics on which you have tried time and again to force a national conversation is the role of the private sector in healthcare delivery. Again, this is a very unique and courageous position given the nature of the consensus.
Yeah, I don't think it's courageous at all. I just try to, it's one of those issues to me that it's the emperor has no clothes issues. You know, we have these passionate debates in Canada about, oh my God, we can't have any private care, it'll be the end of Medicare as we know it. And my answer is always, we have more private care than any system in a developing country in the world except the US. So we have a ton of private care. So to me, the issue is, I think it's a false debate. The debate to me is, where should we have private care and how should we regulate it? So to me, the problem in Canada is we have, you know, poorly administered public care and badly regulated private care. We have the worst of both worlds. And what we need is well-regulated private care and better managed public care. And again, you know, you have to say that, and I back it up with examples and anecdotes, which is what we do as journalists, but I don't think that's a courageous position. I think it's a realistic one. And the thing that I hate the most about the political discussions we have in Canada is that we're so unwilling to discuss practical issues like this. We wrap our beliefs of Medicare around in mythology, much of which is untrue. And it's prevented us from reforming the system and updating it, like, again, as every other country has done. And they don't have that burden of history. You know, I love Tommy Douglas as much as the next person, but I once went to Saskatoon. I was invited to do a speech there, and I started it by saying, because the whole reception before is people telling, oh, Medicare, you know, it has to be 1,000% public. And I got up, and the first thing I said is, I hate to break it to you, but Tommy Douglas is dead. You know, God rest his soul. Well, let's move on. And I wasn't very popular that night, but as I said to Bill earlier, I never eat at the reception because I have to be light in case I have to get out fast. So we'll see what I say to offend you tonight. I'm sure I'll manage.
You're also among the first public intellectuals in Canada that have written about Indigenous health. And as you know, and because you have repeatedly written, especially in recent years, about this topic, there has been no real debate again about what we want to do, what we can do. The last full-fledged model for Indigenous health developed in Canada has been 2001 in the Romano Report. And so...
Yeah, so it's starting to get attention, not near enough, but to me, the state of the health of our Indigenous peoples is the Canada's greatest shame. It undermines a lot of other things we do well. You know, and it's... You know, and again, I think I take the position that I think a society has to be judged on how it deals with its most vulnerable, and that's our most vulnerable, and we do appallingly bad, and it erases so much of the other good stuff that we do. So you're right, I've been writing about this a long time. I was lucky, I was brought up in Northern Ontario where there are a lot of Indigenous people. It was part of the daily reality. I grew up with people who were horribly racist. That was the reality of my time. Today, we're horribly racist, but we're just more polite about it. And that, again, is still the reality. So now, again, on this topic, I'm lucky, again, because I get to travel around the country. I visit a lot of Indigenous communities. And what I've realized over time is that I, too, you know, I perpetuated a lot of these stereotypes. I bought into what I read in the reports that... And I think the biggest problem with Indigenous health is we feel hopeless about it, right? Because report after report, they're what I said, the sickest population, the life expectancy is 10 years less. It's all pretty depressing and hopeless, right? But that's not the reality on the ground. The reality on the ground is like the world writ large. The reality is there's a lot of healthy Indigenous communities, and there's a minority of them that are grossly unhealthy. Just like the world, we have grossly poor countries and we have a bunch of middle class. They're the same thing. So what's the solution? To me, over the years, what I've learned listening to people in these communities is the solution is to stop going in there to save them with these programs and to facilitate nation-to-nation talks. So I was just in Saskatchewan, a Treaty 4, super healthy community, its own health clinic, people have jobs, etc. Bring people from Treaty 4 and bring them to Attawapiskat and let's figure out how to fix it. We don't send people from Toronto or Ottawa. They're not going to fix that Awapiskat. They're going to fix it nation to nation. So to me, that's the kind of things we have to talk about more openly. There's fabulous Indigenous leaders today that give me hope that this is going to change. People like Alika LaFontaine in Saskatchewan. I talk to him often, and he says really interesting things. Like, we have to, this whole stuff about sending outsiders, and he says, the big problem is we have all these side conversations, right? We say all these grand things and how we're going to fix it, but then a couple of bureaucrats go from Ottawa, and they meet the bureaucrats from the First Nation, and they work out a deal, and their family, you know, their family members get jobs, and they get a bunch of money, and nothing ever changes. And that's what we have to stop. And those are administrative and engineering and bureaucratic problems, and that's the issues that are hard to solve, but that need to be solved. So sorry for the long, rambly answer, but I think a really, really important issue. And there's a bunch of columns about Indigenous health in there.
I want to bring things back a little bit to you, because PG and I, we had a debate in the lead up to today. He thought you were 64 years old, and I said you were 44 years old. And we're not exactly sure, but you were meeting with students earlier today, and the reason I allude to your age is, I think many of us would say you have been an incredibly influential person in the domain of health, broadly speaking. And you met with students between 5:30 and 6 o'clock, some of whom are journalism students in the Mount Royal program. And you were presumably talking a little bit about your role. What is the role of people like you and a future generation of health journalists in shaping the public discourse and perhaps influencing policy? And then the piggyback to that question is, do you think that what you do actually has a direct effect on decisions that get made in health?
Okay, those are some big ones, but let me deal with the all-important age question. So, and I'll answer. So someone once asked Gord Downey how old he was, and he answered, which became a lyric in one of his songs, he answered, they don't know how old I am, but they found armor in my belly. 16th century, I think, conquistador. So that's how old I am. But he sings it better than
me. You should have sang it. That's
yeah, what I don't wish that on you. So what influence do I have? I don't know. I hope I have some, but I don't think policy works that simplistically. I've learned that over years. I think my strength has been sort of, I'm like the Chinese water torture test in Ottawa. So, I know the bureaucrats all read my stuff, and the politicians read it, and hopefully I think it just wears away at them. But I think my job is, as I said before, I think of myself as a translator. So I translate this bureaucratic gobbledygook and the research into stuff that's digestible for the public, and I hope that it somehow infiltrates into the discussion and has an influence. But I don't have any pretense about, you know, having power. And I think in journalism we tend to overstate how important we are. I think we often arrive, when the wave's about to hit, and we take credit for being the wave. But that's, it's not a bad thing. But I think we have to be more realistic about what our role is.
Do you have a story of a specific column or piece that you wrote where there may have been, where you were more than just the wave arriving on the shore at that time? Do you have an anecdote, or maybe it's hard to put you on the spot, but can you tell us a story of you wrote something and it really feels to you like it did lead to a direct action?
Yeah, I don't think any one column is going to have a huge impact, but probably the most impactful story of my career without question is the stuff I wrote on tainted blood. But that was years of work, and it ended up being a book as well. But that was an issue. To me, that was an important issue because it was a very small, it's a story that started with a simple question from one of my bosses. So I've written about AIDS since day one. AIDS is sort of the story that arcs through my career, and we can talk about that later. But at a certain point, we use these stock phrases when we write, to give context. So I wrote a lot about AIDS in the 80s, and we'd say, in the early days, AIDS affected four communities. And journalists for shorthand, and this is going to sound rude in retrospect to 30 years later, but we called them the 4-H Club. So there were four groups that were infected with AIDS, and they were homosexuals, heroin users, Haitians, and hemophiliacs. And we used this 4-H to remember that. So we'd always put that in, that's who's at risk, and it was sort of a stupid thing to reassure the public, oh, don't worry, you're not going to get AIDS because you don't want one of these four groups, but that's an aside. But at one point, you know, and we wrote a lot about gay men and protests, and we wrote about the bigotry against Haitian people because of AIDS, and we wrote about drug users and how that was spreading AIDS, and we, you know, made them seem like awful people. But we never wrote about the hemophiliacs. And my boss one day said, like, what's the business with these hemophiliacs? Why do they have AIDS? And I was like, oh, well, I guess because they get blood. And so, well, why don't you look into that? We should do a story. So I started looking into this. And I soon realized that this wasn't just a small problem of infection, that, you know, every hemophiliac uses a lot of blood. And more than 50% of their entire community was infected. Like, this was a holocaust. And, you know, I remember reading these dry data things from a hospital, and it just dawned on me, like, wow, this is a huge story. And my bosses, to their credit, you know, okay, don't file that one for 5 o'clock today. Now let's take some time and do it. And we, in the Globe, we did, myself and a colleague, a huge, I think it was 8 pages in total. Those were the days when papers were thick. And we did a huge sort of expose of this, and half of it was hemophiliacs, and then we learned that, of course, many transfusion patients were infected. And this sort of launched, and then we started to learn why, that we didn't test properly, that the Red Cross lied. They used this stock line that 1 in 1 million units of blood were infected. By the time they started testing, it was 1 in 266. Them's not good odds. You wish we had those in a lottery. But, you know, and we just started exposing. They destroyed all the documents showing that they had stuff. One of the stories that hit me the most was they had, like, this reverse Schindler's List, I called it. They had a list of people that they figured, they're already infected, so we have blood, we know it's infected, and we're going to give it to them anyhow because we're writing them off. And we know that multiple infections makes it worse. So real horrible stuff. And kids were on this list. Just horrific. So I literally wrote those stories for years. Our coverage led to a public inquiry, to the Creever Inquiry, which in turn led to $5 billion in compensation, to criminal prosecution. It was really impactful. And I'm not saying, I don't want to give the impression at all I did this single-handedly, but, you know, that's the kind of story that once you sink your teeth into it, that you can really have an impact. So sorry for the long answer, but...
André, given the you have a very unique pulpit at this time, and there is a... It's no more possible to publish 8 pages papers, and because there is no more 8 pages in any papers. So what do you see for the future? Do you think there's people that will replace you? Are you seeing a generation of journalists and columnists? And where are they? You know, I want their names. I want to know who we should be reading now.
I'll tell you where they are. I was talking to them right before this. They're scattered around the audience, young, enthusiastic, knowledgeable people. They're way more knowledgeable than I ever was at their age. So I kind of am of two minds on the future of journalism. It depends what day you catch me on. Today it's a good day because I'm inspired by seeing these young, enthusiastic people. But I think, you know, the good health journalism today is better than it's ever been. There's really fabulous groups out there like Vox.com, ProPublica, all these who do fabulous in-depth, you know, the New York Times, the Wall Street Journal do amazing health coverage. Now, the bad stuff is worse than it's ever been. We have things like listicles and all this clickbait, and that's depressing. And then, you know, the middle's fallen out, and that's, to me, probably the most disturbing. My hometown paper, the North Bay Nugget, used to have a health reporter. They do decent talk about what's going on in the hospital. And that was solid stuff. And that's gone. That middle, we just don't cover stuff anymore. And it's a void. And it makes for a much worse health system. There's no accountability. Because that's what journalism is ultimately about, is to hold people accountable, right? So I think if we can come on, if we can get people to pay for good journalism, it's going to be great. And if we can get people to pay for mediocre journalism, that would be even better, to be honest. You know, if, because I think it's really important for small communities to have a paper. And if we can get people to stop clicking on all the crap, that would, so I think, you know, it's a mixed message.
Okay, so we have a number of questions. And again, if you don't like the choices, it's Raoul's fault. Just to liven up the audience, when I read out a question, if you recognize it as yours, you're welcome to stand up and say, yay, okay. So we'll see if anybody wants to do that. So first question, it's an extension of the question, and PG, also participate in answering, because I think you're going to have some things to say on these. This first question, how can future doctors bring change and transparency to a system as reactionary and change-averse as Canada's health system? Who wants to take credit for that one? There we go, right at the back, okay.
Yeah, so it's interesting. So I meet lots of med students and nursing students and such, and they know all the right stuff. They know what they want to do. They're going out there and they're keen. And when they get out in the real world, the culture is pretty oppressive, right? There's a lot of pressure to conform. So I think, how's the system going to change? It's not going to just be the young people. It's going to, I think the old timers have to put some water in their wine. You know, I think that's, unless that happens, there's not going to be some change. But it's true, there is this problem with turf protection and conservatism and not always of the progressive kind, et cetera. So I don't know, that's a really hard one. I think our legislators and policymakers have to be a little more active as well, if I can put it that way. And if there's any Ontario doctors in the audience, this is where they'll kill me. But you know, I think some of the contract talks and stuff, we just have to start getting tougher and demand more. And it's not about paying less, it's about demanding more and demanding things be done differently. The money's, you know, money overwhelms everything in these talks about changing physician behavior, but I think it can change in a whole bunch of other ways. It doesn't matter, the money doesn't matter.
PG, you touched on courage when you were, like, you used the word courage several times, and I think that theme is part of the response to this question. Do you want to elaborate on?
Well, you know, it's one of my usual answers to this question is that people don't realize how deep are the roots of health systems most of the time, and change is very difficult because of the deep roots of systems. My favorite example is the German system. All the people will mention it as an example, but the German system has been essentially created at the beginning of the 1930s, so it has survived the Nazis, the war, the reconstruction, the reunification, and it is still basically as it has been conceived in 19. So long, deep roots.
Yeah, and the culture part is something we don't talk about enough. Like, when I hear people say to me, oh, we should just do the German system, right? We should just import it, but you can't. You have to. We're stuck with our constitution, we're stuck with our beliefs, we're stuck with our quirky history. So I think you have to make change within the context of the culture, and that makes it doubly difficult.
Just on this topic of courage, just to extend that for one more minute, in the Institute, in the O'Brien Institute for Public Health, we've really tried to have difficult conversations at times. So Rebecca Saw, who's in the audience, she can wave if she wants to. She hosted a forum on the legalization of cannabis about 10 days ago. And, you know, that's a topic that we're all trying to learn and understand. And it's controversial, no question. And that was interesting. We had a group of citizens called Imagine, and there may be some colleagues from Imagine in the audience. Wave if anyone's here. But we had a difficult conversation about the patient experience of healthcare. And I think it's back to PG's comment about we shouldn't be afraid of difficult conversations. And I think you've demonstrated that in your work. So,
and we have a lot of difficult conversations in Canada. What we don't have is a lot of difficult implementation. So I think we got to work on that part. But.
We're going to try to figure out what makes them clap here in a second. So just on this, here's an implementation question. Should healthcare users receive a statement of their healthcare consumption? I don't know. And I think the person might mean a financial statement or a description of costs and so on. Who?
Yes, that was me.
Okay. All right.
I get that question every single day in emails. It's interesting. People are kind of obsessed with that. And I've tried many times to look into this, and I know a variety of provinces have tried this on, off and on. And what it comes down to is everybody demands it, and when a province does it, and Alberta did a pilot project on this once, we are the land of pilot projects in Canada. That quote from Monique Bégin is in my book. People demand it, and then the politicians do it, and people hate it. They hate it with a passion, because they say, how dare you tell me that I cost $1,000? I pay my damn taxes. Stick your statement up your... That. So it's a weird thing. People want it, but they don't really want it.
What I want to get at is whether people should be told when they're a burden to society.
Well, I'd say no to that. But especially given my age, the question becomes, would it be helpful, right? And I think the answer is, what little research we have on this question is that no, it's not very helpful. If I'm gravely ill and I find out that my care costs $52,000, well, I don't know, what am I going to do about it? Is it going to change how care is delivered? To me, if it's going to change the appropriateness of care, et cetera, yeah. But I don't think individual statements are going to achieve that. And the other part is just a practical one, which is disturbing, but we don't have any idea what a lot of stuff costs. Like, what does a day in the hospital cost in Canada? We kind of assume, everybody says it costs $1,000. I think people pulled that number out their ass. I don't think we have any idea. So if you don't even know that fundamental stuff, I don't know how you do a bill. So
yeah, there is a splendid book by Elizabeth Rosenthal that has been released about a month ago now. The Americans are measuring everything. They're counting everything. They're sending you 5-page bills if you want, but it hasn't changed anything in the system. And she shows that actually it doesn't work.
Yeah. But her book's a really great read because it's disturbing. You pay $52 for a bandage and things like that. My favorite one was from her book is... A nurse came in, a woman had just given birth, a nurse came in and said, oh, you look really tired, do you want me to take care of your baby so you can get 2 hours sleep? Sure. And then she got on her bill, it was like, I forget, like $1,500 per hour for babysitting? I was like, oh my God, like, I wish my kids got that for babysitting, they could pay their own university.
An hospital in Utah last year that billed the fact that after delivery there was skin-to-skin contact between the father and the baby, and you see that on the bill, they charged $35 for that moment.
Yep. So another one on that. I just wanted to point out, Andre has courage, but he said a bad word a little while ago, so, okay. So Donald Trump was president this morning when I checked. I don't know if he still is. How do we overcome the increasingly anti-intellectual tone of public discourse? And that's why I mentioned Donald Trump.
Oh boy, I don't know. that one's got me stumped. I don't know. I often say to medical students, the most important thing you can say is I don't know when you don't. So I'm going to go with that. I don't have any idea. That's disturbing.
Now we do have the director of our School of Public Policy. Yeah. And he's in an academic institution, and some people would consider him to be one of those in the bubble academics. I am, so I can speak that way. But I posed the question in a tongue-in-cheek way in alluding to Donald Trump, but I think we have certainly a different public discourse than I feel we've had in past years, and maybe it's just because of the heavy news coverage that catches every news conference. I don't remember previous press secretaries in the White House like I do Sean Spicer, but but PG and here.
Because they were always hiding in the bushes. You know? Yeah. They didn't come out.
You know, we were discussing that with Lynn before the session tonight. One of the problems we're facing now is that everybody has adopted the language of evidence. And for me, this is a much more important problem at this moment. It was even more clear in the U.S. Everybody comes to the table saying, I have evidence. You want to do evidence-based policy? No problem. I have evidence. You want something that is based on the methods of science? No problem. I have published this here or there. And this is creating a real problem for all people that, you know, 10 years ago or 20 years ago were wishing to have evidence-based policy. And I think we are now facing, this is probably a more important problem for our world, the world of people trying to change the system, that any problem we may have because they don't like books.
And they have alternative facts. We don't just have facts anymore, we have alternative facts.
So whose question was that on the, okay, excellent question. That's Dr. Jim Kellner, and a friend of Andre's.
And he didn't get an answer. He's going to leave disappointed.
Okay. Now chuck it up here. Get things going. Throw it up. It is like WWF here.
So we maybe have time for a couple more questions if audience members behave themselves. So. Is technology creating a two-tier health system, and then the example that's given between urban and rural communities? So who takes credit for that? Okay, excellent question. So is technology and innovation really increasing divides, not decreasing?
Well, so I have a chapter on the book that says the real two-tier, because I hate that expression, two-tier system in Canada, because it's a multi-tiered system, but I say the real two-tier system in Canada is urban and rural. Because of the about the quality and accessibility. The digital part, I think it's mixed. So I think we're delivering some care much better in remote areas because of technology. There's some really excellent telemedicine projects I've seen, like in delivering psychological care in Nunavut from Quebec, sitting in an office in Montreal. Some of that stuff is really great. But then if I go up to places like Nunavut and the internet connections are so poor in other parts of it that they can't do it. They can barely, get online to get information. So that's a divide. But I don't think the technology is the worst part of the rural urban split. I think it's trying to figure out what's appropriate to do in remote settings. You know, we can't do everything everywhere, but what can we do? You know, a good example is, I think a really tough one is dialysis. So in the north, we fly a lot of people south to do dialysis. We'd probably do a lot more of it in the north, but we have this obsession with, it has to be done by a doctor, da, da, da. But there's a lot of home dialysis now, and dialysis could be done by nurses. So I think that's an example of, I think we can tolerate a lot more technology in rural settings. I would put it that way, I guess. So I don't think it creates so much of a divide as we're not using the opportunities that we could to make it better.
Okay, and then this last question before we transition in the program is really an extension of that last one, because it alludes to biologic therapies, which though the biologics are drugs, I mean, many people think of drugs as they do technologies, and the term health technology assessment is even used sometimes around drugs. So the question is, how can we afford the new biologic therapies? And who takes credit for that question? So it's a sustainability question, okay.
So those drug questions are really hard ones, and I think it has to come down to talking a lot more frankly and openly about value for money, right? So some of these biologics are very beneficial. We get value for money at them. Some of them are not so much. Some of them are just grossly overpriced. So you talked about health technology assessment. We have a group called CADTH in Canada that does assessment of drugs now with the Common Drug Review. And they're in the recent last year or so, they're becoming much more proactive. So they released a ruling recently that was really interesting where they said, we would say this drug is appropriate, but only if they drop the price by 50% because it's not giving proper value for money. And I think we have to do a lot more of that. My column today, in fact, is about you know, how we have to be much more proactive about setting drug prices in Canada, how we have the third highest drug prices in the world, and the reason is we're not very interventionist and we're not very demanding, and our agencies are pretty wishy-washy, and I think things like CADTH and the PMPRB, sorry for the jargon, but Patented Medicine Prices Review Board, things like that have to have a lot more teeth and they have to use them. So.
And I just want to do a shout out from your response to Fiona Clement in the Institute, who's doing some policy analysis on approaches to drug policy for Canada. So just wave so people can see you and talk to you. Okay, so with that, a round of applause for the great questions from the audience. And a thank you to PG for this round of questions. And I'm just going to stay here for one more minute and then I'm leaving the stage. But as the transition occurs, I want to just expand on my introduction of Lynn McIntyre. So as I mentioned, Lynn was the Associate Scientific Director of the O'Brien Institute for Public Health. I'm forever indebted to Lynn for helping steer the Institute in its early days. She, in recent years, was the president of the Canadian Public Health Association, and she was recently inducted into the Canadian Academy of Health Sciences, which I have told her is a great honor, but not as good as the Hockey Hall of Fame. With that, Lynn is going to talk about the social determinants of health and population health.
Thanks a lot. So André and I actually go back to 1991, Canadian Institute of Child Health Advisory Council, which would be about 5 years after the Ottawa Charter for Health Promotion and before there was actually a lot of any conversation really about the social determinants of health. So I'm going to start with the matters of life and death. It actually has a compelling analysis of many health issues, but it's the last chapter, chapter 14, on social determinants, where you say the factors that have the greatest impact on whether we develop life-threatening disease are out of the control of individuals. So I guess my first question is, in terms of the geography of a book, why would the most important aspect of health be left for last? And what does that say, actually, about how we address the social determinants of health in Canada?
Yeah, so I don't know. To be honest, I didn't give a lot of thought to the order of the book, but seeing you're sitting here, I'll say I saved the best for last. How's that? How's that for a political answer?
Yeah, so carry on. But the more important issue is, how do we actually raise the public discourse? How can it be not always the last thing that we say that's the most important? Because it's actually, people have often left, or they've actually, you know, never gotten to the last chapter. How do we raise the public discourse on determinants?
Yeah, I think we just have to talk about it more openly. I think we have to aim to have more of a health system as opposed, you know, we have a sickness care system. We do good sickness care. Not very efficiently, but we, you know, when you're in the right place in the right time, you get good care. But I think people know, they sort of know deep down that, yeah, it's important that I have an income, it's important that I have a house, but they don't make the direct connection, right? We don't really think of our health until we're unhealthy, unfortunately. We're busy with other stuff. So I don't know. I don't know how you change that conversation. I don't think you do it easily, but I think from the journalistic point of view, I think we just have to not write separate stories on social determinants of health from time to time. I think we have to integrate it more in our everyday coverage. So for example, when I talk to, we have a health section and we have meetings about what we're writing. So somebody's pitching a story about diabetes. I'm gonna write about this new diabetes drug. So I'll pipe in and say, you know, what you have to say is it's really important that, who has diabetes? People who are poor. And why are, you know, and they eat badly. Why do they eat badly? Because they're poor. So I think you have to make sure, okay, write about your new treatment, that's fine, but make sure you get that context. And to me, that's the most important thing we should do as journalists, and the thing we do most badly is not providing enough context. We just write these little snapshots about things and we forget about the larger environment in which they happen. So, you know, the best drug in the world, well, we know this from diabetes, you can have the best drug in the world, insulin is, but you know, if life gets in the way, it doesn't matter that you have great insulin, life gets in the way. If you're homeless and, you know, have a drug problem and family problems, et cetera. You can't be bothered to take your, you know, all this stuff is way more important ultimately.
So you are a master communicator.
And I wasn't on that last answer.
And yet you use the term social determinants. And many of us in the field have been just in anguish. How do we find a better way of communicating? So perhaps you can just talk about why you still use the term social determinants. And did you think of anything better?
Yeah, well, I still use it because I haven't thought of anything better. And it gives me, my bosses give me grief about it over the, you know, it really makes you, your eyes glaze over, right? So it is hard. So I think I try and avoid it. I'll put it further down in the story. But I think you can write about income. You can write about education. And I think, again, I think people understand that. They understand why it's important to have an education, especially educated people. But, you know, it's really, I think those concepts are fairly straightforward. And I think we don't necessarily, we talk about housing a lot now, but, and the other problem is we think social determinants only matter to poor people. I think that's the big problem, that they matter to everyone. So the one I've been fascinated about a lot recently that I'm writing more about is social isolation and loneliness. You know, that's a real determinant that, and we don't talk about that one, it's sort of down the list, but social connections are so important to our health. And I think that's one that people can really bite into and understand, yeah, that really matters. You know, I don't have any friends, that has an impact on my health. So I think we have to take the opportunities of social realities to talk about as a lead in to these bigger issues. So, you know, we have more lonely people than we've ever had. We have this epidemic of loneliness in the world, and it's literally making people sick. So use that as an opportunity to talk about these, how we live affects our health and not just healthcare.
So throughout your book, you actually use statistics sparingly because mostly the narratives can tell the story. But the column that was entitled Money, the Most Powerful Drug, you actually bravely attempted to define and apply the health statistics of life expectancy, disability-free life expectancy, health-adjusted life expectancy, and then you made a case on the health harm of both low income but also income disparity. So then you state, the numbers should also lead us to ask the question, why is tackling poverty not a health priority? So could you answer that question for us? And really tell us, do you think the numbers are actually an effective tool for change?
I don't think they're that effective a tool, but I think they have to be in there. I think you need, to me, the ideal story is one that has a compelling personal story. It has some data. Because, you know, you need to speak to the policymakers and politicians. And then it has a solution, a potential solution. So if you have those three elements, I think stories can be impactful. But you can't leave the data out. It has to be in there, and you have to try and make it as brief and digestible as possible. But I think it's important. And so that column, for example, what I was trying to get at is that, you know, we often use this measure, oh, life expectancy is improving, therefore things are better. But is quality of life actually improving? You know, this disability-free life expectancy is important. It tells us that on average, people live now about 12 years with a severe disability. And that's very different from living 12 years longer. It's living 12 years longer with medical needs, with social needs, et cetera. And I think when you dig down a little bit and on that stuff, people go, oh, yeah, I guess it's not, you know, the life expectancy isn't all necessarily what it's cut out to be. It's not that, it's great that we're living longer, but are we living better? And I think that's a more important discussion.
For the many researchers and students in the audience, do you have like tips on effective use of numbers and what would help you in terms of the numbers? Because I sure wouldn't ask them to give you Hales, you know, or whatever, but perhaps you just go farther on what numbers you find most useful coming from researchers.
Yeah, so obviously when you're pushing your research or whatever, people use the most grabby numbers, right? So they use like relative risk differences, and this is 50% better, and they don't use the absolute risk. Well, it's gone from 2% to 3% effectiveness of a drug. That's 50% better, but essentially the drug was useless before and it's still useless now. So that, you know, so to me, it's not, use your 50%, I expect that, but also give the other stuff, like be honest, like put it out there, because good reporters are going to find it anyhow, and you probably bad reporters won't, but their stories will be terrible anyhow. So I think, like, to me, be more open about the numbers is the most important thing. Don't use too many of them. You know, try and stick to the basics. Context is always important. I'm always frustrated when I write, say, about diabetes. I guess it's top of mind today to use it for an example, but say there's a whole study about people with diabetes are having amputations in growing numbers, sort of a typical study. And then I'll read the whole thing and I'll say, well, how many people actually had an amputation? And I'm so frustrated, like, what? And I call up the research, oh, well, we didn't study that. Well, hello? I don't care if it went from 12 to 16. What's the denominator? So often, you know, often there's these numbers and it lacks the denominator. It lacks, well, how many people have diabetes? Well, I don't know, a lot, but then the number of amputations going up, that's our story. And I said, well, but it needs to be contextualized, right? So use numbers smartly, I guess, is what I would say.
So this event was advertised with the headline, "Less Poverty, Not More Medicine Will Heal Canada's Health Woes." And then you've got words in your book that say, again, the most powerful drug we have, money, is pretty plentiful. So whose money are we talking about, and where should the first dollar go?
Well, you know, I think I'm talking about collectively, we have lots of money. What I talk about is, I often like to use this analogy because I think it's catchy. Money's a drug, very impactful, but to me it's poorly prescribed, right? Some people have way too much of it, they overdose. A lot of people don't have near enough, so they suffer. And then, the middle people all wish they were up overdosing. So, you know, I think when you put it in those contexts, it makes people sort of think a little bit. But it's also a reminder to me that, things like tax policy is really important to our health, and we don't think in those terms. Maybe it's because I'm an accountant, I think like that, but they really are. Like, redistribution of money is, again, can be enormously impactful. If we look at the countries with better health outcomes than us, like the Nordic countries, many European countries, they don't deliver better medical care. What they do is they have better social safety nets. They have, the single most important factor, if you want to know a country's healthy or not, you don't look at their life expectancy. I think you look at what's the gap between the rich and poor. And the less the gap is, the healthier the country is. And that's, we've known that for 150 years. You know, that's not new, but we don't act on it. In fact, we bring in a lot of policies that perpetuate the discrepancies.
It was just a few months ago since this room was filled with Art Eggleton and others talking about basic income. So I'm just wondering if the column on basic income guarantee, have you not written it yet, or was it not able to be put in this book? And like, what are you saying about basic income guarantee?
Yeah, so it's not in the book, unfortunately. I've been mulling that one for a long time. In fact, I was saying to the students before when we met, this issue, when I did my thesis in journalism school, I actually wrote about basic income. So this was in the early 1980s. So I've been interested in this issue for a long time. And I think I've put it off because it's always hard to write something in 650 or 700 words, a complex topic. But this one to me is doubly complex because it matters so, the details matter so much. Like the notion, let's guarantee a basic income, that sounds great. And especially to people on the left, oh, it's a fabulous idea. But the question, but then you realize, well, people on the far right are all for basic income too. But it depends where you put the needle, right? So we can keep people down here at a basic income, or we can put them here. And then the even more important question to me is that we don't debate enough when we talk about this is, there's an assumption by, I'd say, half the people that if you have a basic income, you're going to get rid of all the other programs, right? That's how we're going to save money. And, well, that would be a disaster. You know, you can give people a basic income, but if we have no social housing, welfare, workers, people to help people with addiction, if you cut all those other programs, the basic income is going to solve nothing. It's going to make it worse. So to me, it's a really complex issue. And even the Ontario study, I think there's a lot of details that still haven't been hashed out. So it'll be interesting to see. But I do have, it's on my to-do list, and I keep sort of bumping it down to number three and doing other stuff because I haven't found it a way of saying it in a pithy enough fashion, this whole complex. Yes, it's a good idea, but, and with a big giant but written this big in the paper.
So my next question has a great big giant but. I see it there. So it says, the big but in all social determinants talks is that, in your own words, knowing more about the underlying factors influencing our health does not discredit healthy living or absolve people of personal responsibility. Rather, we should be empowered, knowing that the social, economic, and political choices we make can influence our health and the health of the population. But the social determinants disempower populations. So the question is, how do we advance action on the social determinants without undermining action because of the big buts around individual responsibility and the need for people to make better choices?
Yeah, so I think we have to, you know, I don't think, again, there's no simple answer to this, but I think we have to talk more about personal responsibility. We don't talk about that. We talk a lot in Canada about our rights, you know, our rights to social programs, our rights to healthcare, but we don't talk about enough about our responsibilities. And I think we have to put them in the context of not equality, but equity. So some people should have more responsibilities because they have more ability to be responsible. Some people need more care, but they're less able to be responsible, in quotes. So I think when you put it in the, when you shine the equity light on it, I think it takes a different, the context is different, and maybe even a harder sell to the public, to be honest. But, and, you know, a lot of people, the other thing about the, you know, we talked earlier about public health people are very conservative, et cetera. A lot of them get really angry when we write about lifestyle stuff. How dare you write those stories about exercise is good for you and, you know, there, I have, you probably know who he is, but somebody who emails me every single day these angry rants about any lifestyle story. And I said, no, we have to write those because our audience is not, you know, our audience tends to be wealthy, middle class, wealthy, and that it will make a difference to them. Marginal difference, but people like to be empowered regardless of what their income or status is in life. And that lifestyle stuff is important, but the lifestyle stuff is not going to help someone who's living on the streets, right? They have 1,000 other things that matter more than their blueberry consumption. But all this to say, I think we have to target our audiences a little bit and not just be self-righteous all the time. Like, it's great to talk about social determinants, but people's eyes glaze over, unfortunately.
Again, you anticipated my next question, and so you've got a subtitle of your book that's called Public Health Issues in Canada, and your beat is Public Health Reporter. So the ambit of public health in what you write about is very broad, yet there's a professional domain of capital P, capital H, public health throughout the country, and you know who they are, and you know they're your friends. I mean, they're your friends. But the situation is arguably dire in terms of the frontline work for public health. And I don't know if you probably saw the Canadian Journal of Public Health commentary from these top public health people about, you know, the end is near. The end is nigh. So, you know, the firing of chief public health officers in multiple jurisdictions, the erosion of programs, et cetera. So the, what do you think the formal public health workforce should do to even out the playing field of, you know, of that territory of public health that they, in fact, you know, have been squeezed out of?
Yeah. So let me start with, you know, my title is interesting because I got this title many years ago, Public Health Reporter, and I realized subsequently that it didn't really mean the same thing to me as it did to my bosses. Like, my bosses just assume, well, he writes about the public health system, right? It never dawned on them that I'd write about public health, capital P, capital H. So it's a funny title, and I think to this day they still think that, so don't tell them. So what can public health do? You know, I think it's like many other things in modern society. They're being squeezed. They don't have a lot of political power. So I think what they have to do is focus on the stuff that gets political attention, and stuff that they do well, vaccination, control of infectious disease. and really sell themselves on, you know, what we know are measurable benefits of doing that, and then use that attention and hopefully that funding to do the other good stuff that they do. And I think public health is actually getting a lot of really good attention with, say, the we're going to talk about the opioids crisis, for example. I think they're getting a lot of respect and attention for what they're doing there. And with vaccination, you know, there's a real, after a few years of, you know, anti-vaccine stuff being popular, I think that that's really moving. People are much more appreciating the value of vaccines and stuff and of public health. But it's a perpetual, you know, and you know this better than I, that the classic problem of an intractable problem of public health is that you can't measure what doesn't happen, right? So the more effective you are at your job, the less you're needed. And that's, you're never going to get over that problem. And I don't know. It has to be, I think, on the part of governments, a leap of faith to fund public health. And, you know, I don't need to say it, we're not in a time of much leaps of faith. We're in a time of leaps of insanity in politics. So
it's really interesting. We're talking about the determinants of health, and 90% of my questions are healthcare issues. But I have one here. How can we be more realistic or ethical in terms of medical journalism or in terms of communication between researchers and institutions? I mean, there's the question is, you know, obviously concern around, you know, again, the integrity of the whole communication system.
Yeah, so, you know, the reality is people hype their research, and there's a whole machinery to do that. And I think, you know, we do a lot of sort of hair pulling, and we're like Jesuits, a lot of self-flagellation about this. But to me, we just have to recognize this is part of the game and adapt to it. So, you know, people are gonna, it's natural that you do research, you're proud of it, you wanna talk it up. Universities want attention, they're gonna pump it up. Newspapers want the clicks, they're gonna hype it up. So I think that's part of the game. And we have to, though, try and moderate it a bit by demanding certain standards. I think as journalists, demanding context, demanding things like the data be presented in a certain way, not just relative risk, but absolute risks. So just some basic stuff that we can moderate. But I don't think we're going to change that whole machinery. That's, for better or worse, that's modern society. You know, it's commercialization and it's pushing stuff, and we have to live with it.
We haven't actually mentioned the elderly population yet today, and so they're growing in Canada.
Well, Bill mentioned my age.
Yeah, that's right. And I mentioned 1991, there, so we can start from there. But, I mean, it's a genuinely vulnerable population, so the question is, you know, what more can be done in our system by policymakers to, in fact, protect this population?
Yeah, so I get asked a lot of questions about the elderly. It's usually they're, you know, are they going to bankrupt the system? So I think the first thing you have to say that I think is really, I always want to stress is this notion that baby boomers are going to bankrupt our healthcare system and our governments more generally is nonsense. The evidence of that is very scant. So I'd like to get that one out of the way. But I think the part of the vulnerability to me is we have to make more investment in prevention. Trying to keep people healthier longer, not over-medicating them, paying attention to the determinants of health. I think we've done pretty well in the elderly with our income supports. You know, that's a real success story in Canada, but we don't do so well on the housing part, for example. And then the other part that we never talk about, which is really important with the elderly, is we have to do a lot more secondary prevention. So when people have cancer or heart disease, you know, they get their treatment, but then they just go back to what they were doing before. You can always make people's lives better, and you can prevent them from getting sicker faster. So we don't do a lot of that secondary prevention, and there's, I think, a great opportunity there. You know, I remember someone saying to me once, and it sounded horrible, but he said, you know, often the best thing that can happen to someone is they have a mild heart attack, because it scares them into doing stuff better. And that's, you know, there's a great opportunity when people are sick to help them get better, but then to change the life that made them sick in the first place.
Well, thanks a lot, because I think the hook is coming. Thanks a lot.
We have a really dynamic young leader, younger than André, in the province, Dr. Hakeek Farhani. Hakeek is a public health physician, so he is trained in preventive medicine and public health. He's a specialist in addiction medicine, and he writes a lot on this topic. He blogs. He's a frequent Twitter. He has a real Twitter presence. An expert in this area, and really doing a lot of the same work in many ways that André does through the media. So, Hakeek, I'm going to turn it over to you, and you're going to take us through some important discussion now.
Thank you. Everybody started with a story of how they know André, and I don't. Well, no, that's not true. I do have a story about that. We don't go back quite as far as 1991 or runs along the canal, but about 6 months ago, I got my first retweet from André Picard, and. If you've not had that experience, I highly recommend it. It looked like the first round of Pfizer commercials for Viagra the morning after that happened. But, I think we should acknowledge that we're gathered on the ancestral lands of the Treaty 7 First Nations. And we often, you know, say that without reflecting a lot, but... In the lead up to a conversation on the opioid crisis, I think it's notable. It was no accident that the first community to declare a state of public emergency around opioids was our very own Southern Alberta community of Blood Tribe, which is a Treaty 7 community. And you wrote in your section on Indigenous health. Brilliant sentence as the lead, and if you don't mind, I'd like to read it. A mad scientist, hell-bent on destroying the health of a population, could probably not imagine a more diabolical plan than this one. And then went on to describe the journey towards probably one of the most shameful disparities in health in the world. And I wonder if you might talk about how that relates to First Nations experiencing a disproportionate impact of the opioid crisis.
Well, you know, I think it goes much earlier than that. We know there's a severe alcohol problem, that any addictive substance is going to hit the most vulnerable the hardest. We know that historically. We know that there's a legacy there of cultural destruction, of trauma, people self-medicating, you know, looking for escape from their pain, physical and psychological. So I think all these elements, and opioids just happens to be the thing that's around now, right? But whenever something new comes along, it's going to hit those communities first, and it's going to hit them hardest, because they're looking for something, and the escape, and it's there.
So interestingly, prior to my leaving conventional public health practice, I worked in the federal government with First Nations Health, and one of the things we used to do was review prescribing patterns for First Nations. And again, no accident that the community's hardest hit by the illicit fentanyl, bootleg fentanyl variety crisis, were those that had exceedingly high rates of opioid prescribing by physicians in those communities. Could you talk about why you think that happened?
You know, I think it's an interesting point, and you know this subject much better than I, but, you know, we kind of think when we casually read the headlines about opioids, you think, oh, it's a bunch of drug dealers on the corner selling stuff, right? And that's not the majority of people who die of opioid overdoses that got them from a doctor. They're prescribed. And again, we often use blame. Oh, these are drug seekers, etc. But a lot of them, this is an extension of just poor medical care, right? It's just haphazard prescribing. It's lack of continuity of care. It's get out of my office, here's a script. You know, it's all this patronizing stuff that leads to this. It's not a simple evil doctor, or it's not a simple guys just trying to get stoned. There's all kinds of other underlying issues there. These are complex stories. And we, you know, we don't tell them very well in our little 500-word stories.
I've never been offered 500 words for an op-ed. They always ask for less than that. So, you know, there's been a lot of talk about looking back at what was the genesis of this crisis, and most folks who comment on this talk about the way that we've prescribed. And you wrote in the first section of your book about the tendency for us to violate the 13th law of Samuel Shem's House of God, which was the delivery of good medical care is to do as much nothing as possible. And while it was said satirically, that feels like it's more and more true. And I wonder, you know, going back to a community like Blood Tribe, when a First Nation patient, and there's a lot of clinicians in the audience and future clinicians in the audience, I think it would be helpful to know, if you were a doctor, a medical doctor who had a person coming from the intergenerational trauma of a First Nation person presenting, complaining of pain, how do you unpack that?
Yeah, so I'm not a doctor, thankfully. I never will be. But, you know, I have a lot of sympathy for that. And how do I do it in 7 minutes, right? Even more importantly. So I don't know. I don't know how you do it. But I think, you know, coming back to that satirical comment, when I do get to speak to medical students, I always say that. I always say, doing nothing is actually a clinical choice. It's not doing anything. It's a choice, and it's as valid a choice as prescribing. Not prescribing and prescribing are two equal choices. And when you put things in those ways, I think it forces you to think differently and think, I think, make it more rational to not do stuff. And, you know, we know this from things like prostate cancer treatment, right? The best treatment for prostate cancer most of the time is doing nothing. It's watchful waiting. And we've raised and we've educated patients to believe that if you leave the doctor's office with nothing, it's a failure, right? The doctor's ripping you off somehow. And we have to change that attitude. But again, when you come back to complex patients with trauma, with social issues, 1001, with real pain, well, what have you learned in med school? What have you learned in all your training? You've learned do something to alleviate the pain. And what do I have? I have this fabulous new drug from Purdue called OxyContin. So why don't I give it to them? It's, you know, it's a totally legitimate, understandable action because it's done out of context. And now, because of 1001 media stories, maybe you think about it a little differently, but I won't give them OxyContin. Maybe I'll give them fentanyl. That's even better, right? So
yeah, talk about mad scientists coming up with diabolical plans.
We understand how these decisions get made, right? But
It's interesting that, you know, as the conversation tends to focus on how we've prescribed in the background, actually now most of our opioid overdose deaths are related to bootleg fentanyls that weren't prescribed by physicians. And there's a concern by many, and I think with good sense, that a stampede kills in both directions or tramples people in both directions. And if the pendulum swings all the way back and we start withholding analgesia from people or not treating use disorders or addiction to opioids or physical dependency to opioids because of a concern that our stats are not going to look so good, that we could do some harm. And I wonder if... what would be your advice to physicians as we, you know, unveil a new national opioid guideline, and as there's no shortage of press around how doctors are at fault for helping to create this problem?
Yeah, I think we have to avoid the being too reactive. You know, not giving in to the hysteria. There is a lot of hysteria now, and I think we can't forget there are people with real pain who need treatment, you know. Bringing down our opioid numbers, it probably would be a good thing, but the more important question is, what are we going to do to treat people's pain that's real? So this isn't working, but what does? So I think it's, again, I use the word context over and over again, but it's the thing we do badly in journalism, and it's the thing we do really badly in medicine and public health. We don't contextualize things. So it becomes these... Well, we got to solve opioids is the story now. We got to deal with this. We got to get our numbers down. We got to get, you know, the administrator off my back. He wants my numbers down 40%. And then we're going to forget about something else is going to come along, right? So because I'm an old timer, to me, we need to talk about opioids more as a failure. It's not just an epidemic in itself, but it's a failure of our system to more broadly. So before opioids, was there? Well, there was heroin. Before heroin, there was crack. And before that, there was, you know, God knows what, I forget, after all these years. But there's always a drug du jour. There's always a crisis. And so what does that tell us? Well, it tells me that, well, these reactionary ways of dealing with it don't work. It just moves the problem elsewhere. It just shoves it upstream or across the street. And it tells me that things like prohibition don't work. You know, I mentioned in passing with PG before that I've become over the years very much a libertarian about drugs. And I think that has to be the solution. We know that all this criminalization and this cracking down on doctors and patients and users, it doesn't work. And we know from other jurisdictions that where you essentially just legalize everything, there's not a stampede to use drugs. You know, it's not very fun to take heroin. There's not going to be 100,000 people who rush out to buy heroin tomorrow because it's legal. It's going to be the same people, and we're just not going to be sending them to jail. So to me, it's a win-win.
You say it's not very fun to use heroin quite confidently. I have to admit, so last month, does everybody follow André on Twitter? If you don't, you should be ashamed of yourselves. Last month, you had tweeted a picture of yourself 30 years ago when you started your job at the Globe and Mail. And I have to admit, I thought to myself when looking at that picture, this must be why he has so much compassion for drug users, because this is a handsome fella who looks like through the 70s and 80s, he might have blazed his way through. And I think people think like that when they see people write compassionately about people who use drugs. And I'll tell you, every time I've written something about harm reduction or supervised injection sites or drug policy, my mom will invariably get a call from somebody who says, everything is okay. Like, so my question, and it's a serious question, is why is it that some people, because you talk to all sorts of folks and you understand how regular people think, and why is it that some people can identify with or have a sensibility about problems that don't directly affect them, but other people react viscerally to somebody's health behavior that doesn't directly affect them?
Yeah, you know, I think it's we are scared of stuff we don't know. I think it's what it comes down to. Again, I have the privilege of meeting all kinds of people in all kinds of walks of life who do all kinds of stuff, legal and illegal. And, you know, what I've realized about things like, you know, I said heroin's not fun. It actually is fun for some people. People you can use it responsibly. I wrote that in a column. It outraged people. But you can use heroin as responsible. You can use alcohol irresponsibly. You know, it depends on the person and the context. I've learned over time that there's probably more people on Bay Street taking heroin and cocaine than there are on the downtown east side. That's the reality. They can afford good, like they don't get sick, right? They do it on the weekend. So when it all comes down to what I said before, you have to be pragmatic about that stuff. That's the reality. So who am I to judge? Well, I'm not going to judge the guy who's making $1.5 million and he's, you know, hyped up every day on whatever, any more than I'm going to judge the kid on the street, who the squeegee kid who I see, you know, I know is sort of tweaked out of his mind. What's the difference? The difference is one has a good income and the other one, you know, has good luck. So
that it's interesting that as we
sorry for all my bad words, Bill.
I quite enjoy it.
Just wait till your mom finds it.
the narrative that we sort of accidentally pursued when we were trying to advocate for more attention on this issue of overdose death, I think might have contributed to a perception that it's a different problem if it affects middle-class white kids. And so we heard a lot of, you'll be surprised, two-thirds of overdose deaths happen in suburban households. The face of addiction is not what you think. And we thought that those were, you know, messages that should resonate because it makes the problem hit home. But does that, like, does that mean that when somebody who lives on the downtown east side who dies from an overdose, it is somehow less loss of value than if an 18-year-old going to university next year kid dies of a fentanyl overdose?
Well, you know, I think the reason we do those stories is because of that reason, because a lot of people just can't associate that. They can't imagine. My child could never end up on the downtown east side. That's unthinkable. So that's why those suburban kids dying at Starbucks in the washroom is much more impactful, because people, it hits home more, for better or worse. And I think, you know, it's not because people are evil, or I think they just don't associate, you know. It's much easier to be compassionate for someone like you than for someone who's not like you. And that's not necessarily racist or bigoted or whatever. It's just a practical reality. So I think in the media we do those stories deliberately because we know they're going to speak to a different audience.
You devoted a section of your book to the war on drugs, and it's a term that we throw around a lot. But when you've reflected on this movement, who do you think the combatants are in the war on drugs?
Oh, you know, I think it's big governments who believe in, you know, fueling the whole criminal justice system, and we're going to crack down and we're going to teach people to behave. And who are the victims? I think ultimately schmoes who smoke up on the weekend and, you know. So, you know, I think it's a war that's a false war. It's just a huge waste of money targeting, as I said, drugs that certain people are going to take drugs, they're going to look for an escape, and they're going to find them one way or another, regardless of, you know, if we spray paraquate on the crops and poison them even more, how's that beneficial? I think that's unethical, and, you know, so we do all kinds of stupid things in the name of justice and keeping people safe, and et cetera.
You wrote in your book that there's also long been a countervailing puritanical need to demonize pleasure and glorify suffering, and it reminded me of H.L. Mencken's characterization of American people as having this haunting fear that somebody somewhere might be experiencing happiness. Yeah. And, you know, looking at the faces of the current White House administration, I can understand why that might disturb some people. One of the questions from the audience has to do, I think, with happiness and mental health. Saying that, rightly or wrongly, that addiction represents a failure in a mental health system. How do we fix the mental health system?
Yeah, so you're quite right that the addiction should be an integral part of the mental health system. It's often almost exclusively a mental health issue. And I think we've made a lot of progress on mental health in recent years, especially about the way we write about it and talk about it in society. But to me, things like Bell Let's Talk, for example, I think a fabulous initiative, but I've kind of soured on it over the years. I've come to the point now where I've started saying that when we invite people to come forward to speak openly, to bust the stigma, to me there's an implied promise there that we're going to help them. And I think we've betrayed that promise, and we betray it every single day by, you know, not having addiction treatment for people. We're way, way behind. And not just opioids, but alcohol, even alcohol addiction, et cetera. Food addictions, there's all kinds of things that could be treated, and we do a terrible job of it. And they're really deadly conditions. They really need urgent care a lot of the time, and we're falling down on the job. I don't know if that answers the question, but...
The person who asked the question satisfied? Good. So the next question, bonjour André, in anticipation of hearing your perspective on prescription drugs, what is your perspective on medical cannabis, and how do you see its adoption occurring or evolving?
Finally, a pot question. As you noted, I've been studying this issue for a long time. professionally. So probably people won't like this answer, but I have a I don't believe in medical cannabis. I believe that we should have legalization of pot and people should smoke it. But it bothers me that we have this drug. And I don't doubt it has benefits. I think it has benefits for some things. But it has terrible research. And it has terrible packaging and terrible clinical, no clinical trials, et cetera. So it bothers me that we've created this, because we're uncomfortable about it, created this odd class of drugs where we ask doctors to prescribe marijuana. And what's the dose? What's the impact? What are the side? We don't know any of this. It's treated differently from every other prescription drug, and I think that's just nonsense. I say just legalize it. If people want to take it for their glaucoma or whatever, all the power to them. I put pot in sort of the same category as grandma's chicken soup. It probably does you some good, but you know, we don't have to prescribe it. We can just take it at our leisure. And along with the phone call from granny or whatever, she can blaze one too if she wants for her glaucoma. But I think it bothers me, this whole notion. I hope we eliminate the whole notion of medical cannabis. I just think it's unhelpful and confusing.
Would you say the same for medicinal heroin?
I think, no, I would say, again, if you want to take heroin for fun, all the power to you. But I think medicinally, we do have research on it. We can actually measure the dosage because it's extracted in a scientific way. It's not grown in Buddy's backyard or in his grow op in the garage, whatever. So that's to me what bothers me about so-called medical cannabis is two different doses are totally different. We have no idea of the THC content or whatever. So it's not to be a prescription drug because it can't be measured.
So next question is sort of the intersection between politics and health policy. What's your assessment of upcoming marijuana legalization? Did Prime Minister Trudeau keep his promise?
Yeah, as far as I know, he's been dragging his ass a bit, but it's going to happen. It's going to be a joyous July 1st, 2018. It's going to be a wonderful 151st anniversary for Canada on that day. But yeah, I think he more or less kept his promise on that one. To me, what bothers me about that is that they've been really slow at actually saying what they're going to do. So I'm troubled by the, I want to know where it's going to be sold. You know, I think that's a key question that we keep tiptoeing around. I want to know what is going to be the legal amount that you can hold. We haven't decided how many grams is going to, you know, there's going to be a cutoff point at a certain point where it's still criminal to possess more than that, because then it's going to be trafficking. But we don't know what the numbers are. So all these little details really matter.
The Czechs have taken the approach of giving discretion to the judges, and the amount that you can apply civil penalties for are amounts that are larger than small.
Yeah.
That sounds like good drug policy.
Yeah, you? Yeah. Well, in Portugal, it's like, what, more or less a 10-day supply of whatever you want, so...
I see we're getting the hook, but I just want to say, I know you've taken heat from physician colleagues of mine out east, and I think I speak for a lot of physicians here when I say that we learn a lot from you, and so we anticipate continuing to read André Picard and hope for a fourth and a fifth and a sixth book.
Thank you.